Hello learners, this is Sangmitra Suryapani from National Institute of Open Schooling. Today we will discuss and learn about the remaining concepts of plant respiration. Earlier we have studied about the glycolysis, what is cellular respiration, how this respiration works in three stages. For this, today we have with us Mrs. Shivani Goswami, who is retired PGT in biology from Mother's International Public School. Welcome to our studio, ma'am.
Thank you.
So, ma'am, can we revise the remaining concept we have earlier studied? Can we have a quick review?
Yes, I think that will be better before we start. If you remember, last time we studied about the basic concepts of respiration, if you remember. And that was sugar molecules, which is C6H12O6, is converted into 6 molecules of carbon dioxide. Water is produced and large amount of energy is being released. As you can see in the visual here, that this concept carbon dioxide molecule is being converted into, in presence of oxygen, carbon dioxide, water, and lot of energy is being used. Diagram on the right side is showing how this energy that is released is trapped in the form of our energy currency, if you recall, was ATP. And the third major part of this lesson the other day was that oxygen is finally required for all the oxidation of sugar molecule. But we have to learn today that this oxygen that we are talking about is required only in the final stage of cellular respiration. How do plants obtain this oxygen? Try and recollect what we discussed last time. They do not have any breathing organs, but they have a very large surface area. And after this,
we also studied about the types of respiration, aerobic,
yes,
and anaerobic.
Yes, yes, if you remember.
I also recalling.
Yeah, and the experiment that we demonstrated, I hope the students remember that, the experiment using yeast in glucose culture medium. And we created an anaerobic environment by putting an oil layer on it, and we demonstrated how carbon dioxide was bubbling in the beaker which contained lime water, and we could see the color of the lime water changing. And that day we also wanted you to try this experiment in another way without the oil layer, where yeast would get an aerobic environment, and therefore we can also study the aerobic and respiration in the yeast organisms. Today our basic requirement of is how the glycolysis is then followed by the next two steps, the
Krebs cycle
and pyruvic acid. So once again, try and recollect, we said that the total cellular respiration consists of three parts, interconnected but very independent: the glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chain.
Ma'am, so these three processes have different location where, yeah, this process occurs?
Absolutely. It's like inside, we discussed the cytoplasm is the site for glycolysis. Mm-hmm. And we also remember that this is a common step for whether there is oxidative respiration or anoxygenic respiration. So, glycolysis takes place in the cytoplasm. Pyruvic acid, that is the end product of glycolysis, depending upon the availability of oxygen, will then enter the mitochondria for its cellular respiration. That will be Krebs cycle in the matrix of the mitochondria, and the electron transport chain, which occurs on the inner membrane of the mitochondria. So, spatial distribution is there for these three interconnected processes to complete the oxidation of the sugar molecule. Please observe that sugar molecule is first phosphorylated, then broken down into two molecules of 3 carbon compound, and then oxidized. How do we know it is oxidized? NAD is being used for accepting those hydrogen molecules that the sugar molecules are made to lose, but in the process it is also producing 4 ATP molecules, whereas we use 2 ATP per glucose to phosphorylate, each glucose molecule is then generating 4 ATP molecules. So, our net gain is 2 ATP molecules here. and there is also 2 NADs reduced.
How many ATP generated out of these 1 glucose molecule?
Yes, glucose in presence of 4 ADP plus 2 NADs produces 2 pyruvic acids, 2 NAD reduced, so we write it as NADH, and 4 ATPs are generated. We must remember 2 were used during the phosphorylation of the glucose molecule. So net gain is 2 ATP molecules and 2 reduced NADs. Then the use of NAD is also very important. Why are we talking about NAD as a molecule which is getting reduced? There is a concept of redox reaction. Respiration is actually oxidation of glucose molecule.
And redox reaction is also having two parts, that is oxidation and reduction.
Absolutely.
So and we have also studied about this.
Last time we did discuss, and that we made it clear that while one molecule is getting oxidized, there has to be another molecule which is accepting those units of reduction. So if glucose is losing its hydrogen or its electrons, it is getting oxidized, and there is a simultaneous acceptor of these hydrogens. In this case, these are the 2 molecules we will talk about, is the NAD, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, and FAD, ferredoxine adenine dinucleotide. These 2 molecules accept the hydrogens from the glucose molecule step by step and oxidize the glucose molecule. Our next visual will show you what we studied earlier and
the experiment which we have done.
Yeah. And also their everyday use of these anaerobic respiration that we talked about.
We use it in making idlis, dosas, and for making alcohol also.
Also, you know, it's our common experience, if suddenly one fine morning we get up and start doing exercise, next morning we can't even lift our limbs because it hurts, it pains. It's because of the accumulation of the lactic acid. So our lactic acid accumulation, alcohol production by yeast, these are all examples of anaerobic respiration that occurs in absence of oxygen. And as we recall, that pyruvic acid is converted either into ethyl alcohol or into lactic acid in absence of oxygen to regenerate these molecules called NAD, so that they are available for continuation of glycolysis, at least in the cytoplasm. So that is till there we finished last time. Let's proceed beyond this now. So what are the 3 steps? Once again, friends, the glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chains are the 3 interconnected steps. We have understood the pyruvic acid production during glycolysis. Let's see what happens next. This pyruvic acid enters in presence of oxygen into the mitochondria. Our screen shows that the pyruvic acid produced over here is pushed into this mitochondria. The yellow structure is our mitochondria. You can observe the cristae in the inner membrane. This is the outer membrane. This is the matrix of the mitochondria.
That is inner part of our mitochondria.
Absolutely. This pyruvate now enters our Krebs cycle, but before it can enter the Krebs cycle, it has to be processed and converted into a 2 carbon molecule called the acetyl CoA. During this conversion of pyruvic acid into acetyl-CoA, observe, friends, pyruvic acid is decarboxylated and oxidized. So on one hand it is losing a carbon, on the other hand it is losing hydrogen. So we get carbon dioxide and reduced NAD produced to convert pyruvic acid into acetyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA, can you count how many carbons are there on the screen? Yes, it is a 2 carbon compound. Now this acetyl-CoA is accepted by the 4 carbon molecule called oxaloacetate, and this blue circle is representing the Krebs cycle after the person who first discovered the stages of the cycle. So we, Hans Krebs was the person. We also call it a citric acid cycle because the first product after accepting the acetyl-CoA that is formed is a citric acid. So now let's follow the processes that occur in the citric acid. There will be 3 things we will discuss and observe right now. One is decarboxylation, that is removal of carbon one by one. Second is oxidation, that is hydrogens will be removed. So we will produce some of the reduced coenzymes, either NAD reduced or FAD reduced. And thirdly, there is also a position where ATP generation occurs. Let's go from hum.
Yes. We have three steps.
Yeah.
That is decarboxylation and removal of hydrogen and then generation of ATP.
Absolutely.
Molecule.
And this whole process therefore is actually known as oxidative decarboxylation. So as we see that acetyl-CoA is accepted by a 4-carbon oxaloacetate and produces a citric acid. And citric acid in two different steps is decarboxylated as well as oxidized. So we call it as an oxidative decarboxylation.
So ma'am, can you please elaborate this oxidative decarboxylation?
Right. Decarboxylation, the name tells, is the removal of carbon dioxide, and oxidation, as we recall, is removal of hydrogen, addition of oxygen or removal of electrons. In this case, we are observing removal of hydrogen. Friends, at the end of electron transport chain, we will come back to a budget of ATP production. There we will account for every hydrogen the sugar molecule has. Try and recollect how many hydrogens sugar molecule has. It has 12 molecules. So we will have 12 hydrogens removed from the sugar molecules and hand it over to oxygen molecule to produce water. So that is why we call it as decarboxylative oxidation. So
actually sometime learners confused with this cycle.
Yeah,
because they have there are many production of these
intermediates
too.
Precisely. So once again, these are different colors that the visuals are shown. See, the NADs are produced shown in yellow color, whereas the carbon molecules in the substrates are shown by blue rounds. So try and count them. A 4-carbon oxaloacetate accepts a 2-carbon acetyl CoA, produces a 6-carbon citric acid. This citric acid at two different steps is losing 1 carbon each and produces a 4-carbon compound. We call it a succinyl CoA. And in the process of this conversion of citric acid to succinyl CoA, it is losing 2 carbons and hydrogen at two different places. That's why we call it as a stepwise reaction. This particular stage, when this succinyl CoA is further converted into other 4-carbon compounds, ultimately producing oxaloacetate back, it also produces an ATP. Friends, I would like you to count the number of hydrogens that is removed from pyruvic acid while it is entering the Krebs cycle. Yes, count them. It is 1, 2, 3 and 4 NADs reduced and 1 FAD reduced here per pyruvic acid. Therefore, there will be 8 NADs produced and 2 FADs produced per glucose molecule. And so also there will be 2 ATPs per Krebs cycle for 1 glucose molecule. This is the balanced equation for Krebs cycle. 2 pyruvic acid per glucose molecule in presence of 8 NADs and 2 FADs and 2 ADP, adenosine diphosphate, gives us 6 carbon dioxides, 8 reduced NADs, 2 reduced FADs and 2 ATP generation. This is for 1 glucose molecule. Now, we have plenty of reduced molecules of NADs and FADs.
So, what is the significance of this Krebs cycle, ma'am? How this fatty acid gets entered into the cycle and how?
Yeah, it's very important. Very important concept. Why have so much of integrated processes here? Actually, as we saw, the pyruvic acid is getting oxidized in steps. That's one thing, to oxidize the glucose. But food consists of fats and proteins, not just carbohydrates. So even these two types of substrate, that is fats and proteins, also can enter the Krebs cycle for their oxidation. They cannot enter glycolysis. They cannot enter the Krebs electron transport chain directly. So this is the only place where, if we have to oxidize fats and proteins for energy production, this is the only site. Fats undergo breakdown. If you remember, fats are a very large molecule. Mm-hmm. So they first are broken down into smaller molecules. We call it as beta oxidation. So they are broken down into smaller compounds, and as acetyl-CoA enters pyruvate Krebs cycle, they also gain entry. For as far as amino acids are concerned, amino acids and sugars have some basic difference, that is in having an amino group, amino acids. Now if we remove those amino acids and rearrange the carbons, they can easily gain entry into the carbon Krebs cycle. There is another utility of Krebs cycle. Just as it can go forward, oxidize the pyruvic acid, it can go the other way round and generate the products. So if amino acids can be broken down into simple molecules and release energy, they can also be generated in taking the steps, Krebs cycle steps, in a reverse order. So it gives rise to biomolecules also as per the requirement of the cell. So this is a cycle which has multiple utility, not only for oxidizing glucose, also for oxidizing fats and amino acids, but generate the biomolecules as and when required. Friends, this is our mitochondria on your screens. Mitochondria, just one crista is shown, and try and recollect what I told you, that this is a matrix of the mitochondria. Krebs cycle has operated here, generating 8 NADs, reduced NADs, and 2 FADs per glucose molecule. They have to be oxidized again so that the process of Krebs cycle continues. Now let's see what is the fate of these reduced molecules in our electron transport chain. This is the site where electron transport, the receptors are present. We call them as cytochrome enzymes. This is a highlighted schematic representation of that one single crista. You can see, friends, these complexes. Try and recollect, this is the bilipid layer of the inner membrane. In that, there are some structural proteins and then some functional proteins. These are the constitutive proteins which are acting as respiratory chain enzyme. There are other protein types. We are concentrating only on the cytochrome enzymes today, and we divide them into complex 1.
We can see there is a 3 structures which are basically shown. So they are they differ in functions?
Yeah, we call them as complex 1, called the NADH dehydrogenase. The name tells you, dehydrogenases, that is oxidizes NAD. Okay. And the second complex is our cytochrome BC1 complex. This has function of pushing the protons into the outer chamber of the mitochondria, and the electrons is handed over to our next complex that we call as a cytochrome oxidase complex, or it is also known as cytochrome AA3. Plus we have, this is a mobile electron acceptor, and this is a extrinsic electron acceptor, cytochrome C. We call this as ubiquinone. Once again, we have 3 complexes: complex 1 NADH dehydrogenase complex, complex B and C, and complex cytochrome oxidase or cytochrome AA3 complex. Besides these, we have one F1 element particle also. This is known as F1 particle or elementary particle, which has a tennis racket like structure. Remember, this is a matrix site which has a swollen tennis racket head and a handle. This part provides a passage for the protons, as we will soon learn the function of. This head acts as an ATP synthase, that is, when energy is available, it adds one inorganic phosphate to ADP molecule and produces an ATP. That's our ultimate goal in electron transport chain. Now let's study the process of electrons being handed over to oxygen molecule, how it occurs. Friends, remember, we had so large number of reduced NADs and FADs. Now they are the ones which are entering the electron transport chain. Observe and trace the red arrow that shows the path of the electrons, and observe the other blue arrow which shows the path of the proton. So where do they come from? This NADH, the hydrogen part, is split into the protons and the electrons. Protons are gradually shunted to the outer chamber. Energy for this shunting is obtained from these high energy electrons, which follow a downhill path. So the electrons over here have a much higher level of energy as compared to the electron that reaches here and finally gets oxidized to the handed over to oxygen and forms water molecule. Here, the idea is twofold. Create a proton gradient in the outer chamber and de-energize the electrons and hand them over to oxygen to generate water molecule.
I must say say all my learners that we have to explain when we writing answer for this question, we have to explain the role of these proteins, the coenzymes which are involved into this electron transport chain.
So, our coenzymes are actually bringing all the hydrogens removed from the glucose, then subsequently the pyruvic acid, then the oxaloacetate, etc., from glycolysis and Krebs cycle to electron transport chain, finally to regenerate those oxidized states of the coenzymes. Hmm. But we need some acceptor for these hydrogen, which will ultimately be handed over to oxygen to produce water.
Hmm.
But where is the energy coming from? That was the primary requirement of respiration.
Yes.
So, this is the story here on the screen. You can see proton gradients being created using the energy of the electrons. The next part of the story is what happens to these protons that are pushed to the outer chamber.
Yeah.
And that is where our F1 particle comes in handy. This F1 particle, if you can observe, we have a high concentration of protons in the outer chamber. When enough proton gradient is created, they will try and move down their concentration gradient and they look for a passage, and our F1 particle provides that passage. There is a pore, this is a protein complex which allows the protons to rush to the matrix from the outer chamber, and as they do, their potential energy in them is utilized by the ATP synthase, that's the head of this elementary particle, to add the inorganic phosphate to ADP and generate an ATP molecule. So, this is the story of ATP generation in the electron transport chain. As we are handing over the protons back to the matrix, the energy created while the protons are rushing in, and that energy is stored in the form of ATP.
ATP.
Yeah. So, this I hope learners have understood this concept. It's a little complex, but if you read it once or twice, you will always be able to retain the details of it. This is just an overall view of whatever we have talked in respiration. Observe, glycolysis is producing two ATPs and also two NADs reduced. Then pyruvic acid enters Krebs cycle, and from Krebs cycle the products are reduced coenzymes which enter the electron transport chain, where they get finally oxidized to their oxidized state, that is NADH into NAD and FADH into FAD, producing large amount of ATP and carbon dioxide and water.
Here we can see the overall budget for aerobic respiration of one molecule of glucose. Can you explain how many ATP molecules have consumed during the whole respiration process?
Yeah, one glucose molecule, we always teach our learners, produces 36 molecules of ATP in eukaryotes and 38 molecules of ATP in prokaryote cells. Let's have a look at the visual and count them ourselves. Observe the number of ATPs that are going in glycolysis, it's 2. And observe how many ATPs are generated, it is 4. So, net gain is 2 ATPs. Plus, there are 2 NAD reduced also per glucose. So, our net gain at the end of glycolysis is 2 reduced NADs and 2 ATP molecules. Next step was our Krebs cycle. The Krebs cycle in blue color is showing production of carbon dioxide, production of 6 reduced NADs and 2 reduced FADs, and between pyruvic acid and Krebs cycle there are 2 NADs reduced and 2 carbon dioxides. All these NADs and FADs that are reduced during glycolysis and Krebs cycle now enter the last phase, the electron transport chain. Friends, each reduced NAD produces 3 ATPs, that is the molecule has the amount equivalent to production of 3 ATPs, and 1 FAD produces 2 ATPs. So, if we now calculate how many NADs are reduced in the process, of glycolysis and Krebs cycle, you can see there are 10 NADs reduced and there are 2 FADs reduced. Calculate the number of ATPs. 10 into 3 is 30. 2 into 2 is 4. So, 34 ATPs on the electron transport chain directly. Plus, we had seen two ATPs as the net gain during glycolysis and 2 ATPs produced during Krebs cycle per glucose molecule, and that adds to 38 molecules. But we say it is 36 in eukaryotes for the simple reason transporting pyruvic acid across the mitochondrial membrane takes some energy. And that energy is used. So, net gain we usually say 36 or 34 ATP molecules. That is how we take the budget of ATPs during the process. So, our next topic in the lesson was what are the factors that influence the rate of respiration. Obviously, it will be the substrate that we are using as our oxidative material. It can be carbohydrate, it can be fat, it can be protein. Depending upon the respiratory quotient, which is actually a measure of amount of oxygen, carbon dioxide given out divided by the amount of oxygen used during the total oxidation of 1 mole of that substrate. Sugars give us the value of 1 or little less than 1, so also do the proteins. Whereas the fats give us a value much more than 1 RQ, because if you remember the molecular structure of any fatty acid, they are large molecules and they have plenty of oxygens in them. So they need relatively little less oxygen. So they give you a larger RQ value. So we generate lot of energy when we are oxidizing fats. And we get usually equal amount of energy when we are oxidizing either glucose or proteins. But we must remember over here, usually our body mechanism prefers oxidizing sugar followed by fats, and then lastly it is the protein.
So learners, now you have understand about the plant respiration, how this plant respiration occurs, where it occurs, and what are the processes involved into this respiration, that is glycolysis, Krebs cycle and electron transport chain. Thanks to our ma'am for coming to our studio, and thanks to our learners.
प्रकाशित करने राहों को आलोकित करने हम अपना दीपक स्वयं बने हम अपना रास्ता स्वयं चुने कहीं पढ़े